Welcome to the briefing. This is a special briefing this afternoon. And before we get started, I just want to point out that we'll go through the first part of the briefing, and then I will be here in the aftermath of that to answer any additional questions on other subjects. With us this afternoon is the Deputy Secretary of Defense, Dr. John Hamre. And with him are a small fraction of the people in the department who are focusing their attention on the subject that Dr. Hamre is going to be talking about, which is the Y2K problem and the various programs that we have underway to address that that problem. The department's chief information officer, Art Money, is here. His deputy, Marv Langston, is here. And then Bill Curtis, who is the department's principal director of the Y2K office, is also among those sitting over here to the side. Also, there is Army Lieutenant Colonel Warren Patterson, who is a part of the joint staff who has been working on this issue. And with that, I'll turn over the podium to Dr. Hamre.
Thank you, Michael. Art and I were laughing when Mike said it was a small fraction. I mean, I said, that's on a numbers basis, not a weight basis, okay? I mean, for another department, huh? Art gave me this yesterday, and I just want to report there are 351 days, 10 hours, and 26 minutes until the millennium occurs, at least here in Washington. I think this is on Eastern Standard Time. And I would like, if I could, to put the bottom line message up front for everyone, which is the Department of Defense will be able to protect the United States of America and its allies in 351 days and 12 hours. There's not a question about that, and I hope to go through that with you today. Let me go to the first chart, if I could. What I would like to review is where we are. We just had a day-long session on Saturday, about 200 people that we met with, all of the senior leadership of the department, the military departments, the defense agencies, to look at where we are for the year 2000. And I must confess, this was for me a crucial session, because when we set this time, it was about 6 weeks ago when, frankly, I didn't think we were going to do nearly as well. And so we put a very firm marker down that on the, I think it was the 9th of January when we did get together, that would be the test as to whether we would continue to let the individual departments run the programs or whether we would take them over and to try to accelerate things. And I would like to basically give you the results of what we found out at the at our review last Saturday. Back in the summer when we were tracking, and this I should say are mission critical systems, this means that if any one of these systems is not functioning, that some critical element of the department's activities we couldn't execute, we would fail. And so this is anything from nuclear command and control down to individual weapon systems where we are tracking. And we're tracking, as you can see, 2,300 systems that fall in this category. What alarmed us was back in September, in August, when we were in this category and we had 2,300 to go, the progress line was moving like that. And so we went into hyperdrive here in the last 2 months. And as of the end of December, 1st of January, we have 1,673 of our systems that are fixed. Now, let me just say, this isn't just that we're telling you they're fixed. This is an independent corroboration and certification that they're fixed. Now, we're going through another test program in addition to that. So this is what 1999 is dedicated to, is realistic testing, and we will go through a bit of this. Colonel Patterson is going to show you one example of some of the testing. But as of right now, we are 1,673, and I'll show you some bar charts just shortly. This is the target date that has been specified for us by the President to to have things ready, and we will have about 94% of our systems fixed as of the end of March. And we absolutely will have 100% done by the end of the year. Let's go to the next chart if we could. This is where we stand today. 81% of our systems are Y2K compliant today. Now, I will tell you that of the 81%, 8% of them involve fielding. So, for example, we have a proven fix for a ship, a destroyer. But not all destroyers have been outfitted with the fix. And that's what this little shaded area represents, is it's a fix, the system works, we've proven it works, but it isn't completely fielded yet in the service. So that, just in truth and advertising. As you can see, that gets smaller because as we have less than 1%, actually it turns out there are 6 systems that will not be fully deployed by the end of the year. But I'll give you an example. One of them is THAAD, the Theater High Altitude Air Defense System, and its IOC, its initial operational capability, is 2006. You know, so it isn't a problem. We will be 100% ready by the end of the year. Okay, next chart, please. We are going to be spending much of this year in very, very detailed testing. Let me help you read the chart. This is, of course, the months of 1999. These are the various commands. And let me say, the Secretary really motivated a solution to year 2000 around here when he turned to the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs and the Vice Chairman and to the SINCs, and he said, this is a warfighting issue. Rarely do you know the time and the place and the date precisely when the enemy will attack. But we do know in this case. And it's at midnight on the 31st of December. And he said, this is a warfighting issue. This isn't just a computer geek issue. This is a warfighting issue, and I'm holding you responsible for it. So he put the SINCs in charge of testing to say, I've been given a system. It reportedly has been fixed, but it's going to be the SINCs who are going to test it end to end to find out if it really works. This is the test schedule. Each one of the SINCs, and these are test windows, and we will go through one. Colonel Patterson's going to go through one that we have already conducted out at SpaceCom, where we are doing detailed testing, end-to-end testing, for each of the systems. Now, this captures not 100% of the functionality, but enough to confirm that the fixes are in place. And we will go through that in just a second. Let's go to the next chart, please. I'd like to point out that there are broad phases for our efforts here. The remediation phase is that first chart, all of the systems, and are we getting them corrected? Identify what needs to be fixed, fixing them, testing them to make sure they're fixed. And that phase is going on, and it will largely end here by the end of the year. It phases out. I mean, actually, we are now going to track each individual system that's left because we've now accomplished so much. By the end of March, we will largely have, we'll be down to 100, 150 or so. At the same time, we're doing contingency planning. So if something were to go awry, what would we do? So if all of a sudden we don't have a certain, so for example, a mission planning system for an aircraft, how will we work around that problem? And that's also going to be done during the testing phase that you saw for each of the unified commanders when they're doing that work. Operational testing is underway, as I showed you in the previous chart, throughout this period. And this is where we'll do the end-to-end testing. And I'm going to turn to Colonel Patterson very shortly to give you a sense of that. Let me point out there's something new that we'll be shifting our emphasis to now, and that is consequent support planning. We don't know what problems might occur. We think they're actually going to be very modest because we think the bulk of the country is really doing what we're doing, is really getting on top of this problem. But not knowing that, we're going to go through a series of exercises to determine where would we be called to do supplementary support activities. And how would we do that? And we'll be doing that over the next couple of months. This is in a coordinated effort for the federal government. We are obviously the only part of the federal government that is not optimized for peacetime day-to-day operations. We mobilize. So we can bring assets to the table that are qualitatively different the day before and the day after. We're the only part of the federal government that can do that. And so we have things like power generation capabilities and air traffic control capabilities, water purification, things of this nature. And we'll be doing some tabletop exercises to find out what do we need to do and how will we command and control those activities. Let me again emphasize, we have a lot of insight into what's going on in the private sector. And we are really very confident that we're not going to have the wide-scale disruption that some people have been forecasting. We think it's not going to be nearly so significant, but we are prepared to do the detailed planning to be supportive where we have to. And then finally, we will participate in the Year 2000 Operations Center that's going to be set up. We will probably provide a lot of the communications and things of that nature, and that will be starting up this fall. I'd like to turn very quickly, if I could, to Colonel Patterson. I will come back. I've got a wrap-up chart, and we'll come back to that. But if I could ask Colonel Patterson to come up and to give you a rundown on an operational evaluation we actually undertook to part of this testing that's underway. Colonel Patterson?
Thank you, sir. Okay. Good afternoon. I am Lieutenant Colonel Warren Patterson, and I am currently assigned to the Joint Staff Year 2000 Task Force. And I am specifically the branch chief for the Operational Evaluations Branch. We were stood up about 5 months ago and tasked or chartered to design the process and the methodology that the individual SINCs would use in conducting their individual ops evals, operational evaluations. Let me clarify something up front so we have the terminology down. There is a major difference between a systems test and an operational evaluation. The systems have already undergone tests through the awning services and agencies before they are brought into the operational environment. When the SINC comes online to conduct an operation evaluation, one of the ground rules is that he has to bring with him systems that are already Y2K compliant, or a contingency plan is in place for that system that may not be Y2K compliant. So that's one of the basic ground rules. Back in December of 1998, specifically from the 2nd through the 4th of December, SINC NORAD conducted the first in a series of operational evaluations. In fact, it was the first in what will be a series of roughly 27 operational evaluations between now and September 99. It was the first in a series of operational evaluations that SINC NORAD will in fact do over the next few months. Next slide. The first mission, and once again, let me clear something else up about the operational evaluations. The purpose, again, is not to test the system, but to evaluate a SINC's ability to do a mission, the process that the SINC has to undertake. That's the purpose of the operational evaluation. The first mission that SINC NORAD elected to do was his ability to perform the strategic early warning mission, or ITWAA, Integrated Tactical Warning Attack Assessment. He did this successfully, bottom line up front, very successfully. That is the logical first mission to start with. SINC NORAD is charged with a three-piece mission, the first piece being early warning and detection, second piece being execution, the third piece being post-execution. So logically, the early warning piece was the first piece that the SINC needed to do. I want to tell you up front, it was a great effort. It was a team effort all the way. It was a collaborative effort with SINC NORAD leading the way, supported with personnel, facilities, and equipment by SINC Space and SINC Strat. Next slide. Now let's talk a little bit about what it all entailed to get there. It was a three-day exercise from the 2nd to the 4th of December. It entailed going through five what we call midnight crossings. DOD and the Joint Staff has mandated that each SINC, as a minimum, go through four midnight crossings or four dates. These are the dates that we find or we think will be most vulnerable in the year 2000. SINC NORAD, I want to point out, not only did the four dates that we mandated, but he took it one step further. He did a fifth date, 31 December 2000 through 1 January 2001. Five critical dates, all successfully crossed over a three-day test period. He did it at 12-hour intervals each day. The reason he kept it at 12 hours, it allowed him time to come out of the virtual 2000 environment, to roll back into 1998 to check his equipment, his software, and his hardware out, and prepare to go back into 2000 the next day. During that 3 days was a very intense op tempo. He injected 30 missile events into his sensors. So it was a very robust, very high op tempo 3 day exercise. Again, success from beginning to end. Very well thought out, very well planned. Next slide. Okay. I put this up not to tell you that I'm a technical whiz, because I'm not. I'm an operator, a warfighter, but this chart shows the complexity of what they had to do in a three-day period. Very complex exercise. The first thing that I want to point out is it was a three-tier approach. His process to conduct that early warning mission was three-tier, starting with a sensor level, the early warning sensors out there, correlation centers, and the decision makers. Sensor sites, information, they detect the warning launch. Information is fed through communication systems into a correlation center where the information is received, it's cleaned up, it's analyzed, and it's re-disseminated back out down to the decision makers located at three separate sites, STRATCOM headquarters, the National Military Command Center here, as well as Site R. So you see, this is a very complex operation that they had to undergo. I also want you to point out to you that there are 24 systems involved in his architecture that he designed, 24 systems, spread out over seven locations on a very large geographically dispersed area. Of the 24 systems, I want to point out in the lighter blue here, these systems all had clocks in them that had to be synchronized and rolled forward and rolled back through the critical date. So that was 19 systems out of 24 that the operators and technicians had to synchronize to go into the virtual year 2000 environment and come back out of. He was able to do all of that using in-house assigned personnel, operators, and technicians. It did require, because of complexity, to bring in roughly 18 technicians from outside his organization to help with this. And that's part of what we do in the operation evaluation branch to line up these things, schedule them, and help with any technical assistance that they may need. Next slide. This is my final slide. I just want to point out, number one, bottom line up front, 3-day, very complex exercise, highly successful. My hat's off to Sync NORAD, Sync Space, and Sync Strat. Very well done, very well planned, very well executed. They found that there was no degradation in any of the systems, whether they were in a year 2000 environment, a virtual year 2000 environment, or whether they were in a real world 1998 environment. Systems operated as they should as far as the data going into one end and coming out the other end within the prescribed time frame, accurate, unambiguous, clean data. They did a great job, and we are highly confident now at this point that Sync NORAD can do his early warning mission. Any questions?
Yeah, when you say 30 events.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I just want to clarify. You meant, how did you, so you had like 30 incoming missiles, or was this done on the computer, or how exactly did you do that?
I can't tell you the technical aspects behind it, but they're able to inject simulated.
I asked exactly this question on Saturday when we got the briefing. This was data that was injected as though it was coming, it was being sensed for the first time by a radar site. We ran 30 different scenarios. It wasn't just 30 different warheads coming in. So it was 30 different scenarios that were run over this 3-day period of time. So it was a very robust test environment.
Each of them involving one incoming missile?
No, they were different configurations. Some were large configurations and some were small.
So
different azimuths, different directions.
There were 30 different simulations, some of them being mass attacks,
yes.
Some of them being single missiles and...
Yes.
And all variants.
And in every case, the systems worked as designed.
Yes, how much work or reconfiguring or rewriting of code did NORAD have to do to become compliant?
I don't know the answer to that. We'll have. Do you know
we don't know the answer. We're now analyzing the data as it's coming in, and we can pull that type of information out.
We'll get an answer for you on it. I don't know. Let me go to the last slide, and then I'll open up to questions, and I'll ask you first. Okay. So let me again get back to where we started. We now have 31 days, 10 hours, and 9 minutes. But I don't think it may. I don't know.
It's going to break a second before.
That's what's going to happen.
Go back to 1900.
But I don't think we're going to be having any difficulties. I mean, and I feel that way now after having had a very extensive review. Hats off to Art Money, to Marv Langston, to Bill Curtis for having done some heroic work. I should also say Jerry Halton, Undersecretary of the Navy, is here, and Jerry has been doing just yeoman work making sure the very complex problems inside a very complex service, because remember, so much of the Navy is deployed all the time to try to integrate this into a coherent program. As I said, our warfighters are doing the testing. This is independent testing. This isn't just a case where somebody says, I'm fixed, and trust me. I mean, we have independent checking to make sure this is going to occur. There are detailed contingency plans that are being developed. They're mostly in place now for individual systems, and we're doing mission-wide contingency planning as well during these next couple of months. We have, as you would expect, placed special attention on our nuclear systems. And by that, I mean the nuclear system's big picture, early warning, custody issues, safety control issues, the whole works, to make sure that it's totally under positive control. And we are fully prepared to participate with the President's wider efforts to make sure that the federal government is going to be able to function successfully in year 2000, and that we can support any disruptions that may occur in the American public. Okay, let's turn off the slides, and let me turn to you for the first question.
Sir, on any given day, a certain number of computers are probably on the fritz, blowing smoke and causing their operators to curse and kick. Is Y2K likely to be any worse than that?
You're obviously going to have individual, my computer in my office the other day went kaflooey, and we had to straighten it out. You're going to have that sort of thing. But it isn't going to be, the bigger problem isn't that a computer is going to all of a sudden go blank, it's that it's going to calculate unreliably. And so that becomes the critical test. And we do not believe that's going to be a key problem. And we think it's going to be easy to differentiate between the system working and an individual computer having a problem or a hiccup.
Just one perspective question. You have 1.4 million active duty troops and you have something like more than 2 million computers. Do I have those numbers about right?
I don't know the numbers, but that wouldn't surprise me a bit. I mean, just because you go to any command center and you're going to see dozens, of computer systems, not just computers. So, no, that wouldn't surprise me a bit. Yes?
So when I talk to service members, they got two big questions. The first one usually is in regard to the Y2K, are we going to get paid? And the second question is, should we be doing something special about our health records and personnel records with the Y2K coming up?
There's no question they're going to get paid. The systems, the pay systems are already year 2000 compliant. And they will be going through testing to make sure that they function on the expected host platform, that is the new computer systems, the underlying computers that will be running them. That'll be happening here in March and April. So I don't think there's any question. Now, it's more complicated than just will our computers properly calculate pay. We have to get the electrons over to the Treasury Department. Treasury Department has to pass on those electrons to the banks. The banks have to spread it out to all over. We have, I think, something like 800 banks that we do business with on a day-to-day basis. And each one of those banks has to go through a detailed process. We've got to make sure the allotments are properly distributed, et cetera. The Treasury and the Comptroller of the Currency are working very intensively with the banking environment. I know this because my brother's a banker in a little bank in Iowa, and he complains all the time about how intrusive we are and making sure his systems work. I feel pretty good about that. On the personnel records, those were also part of the system. Every single personnel record, the DEERS system, et cetera, is going to be Y2K compliant. Most of them are already fixed today.
In October, you said that you anticipated the Y2K problem would be a nuisance, not a crisis. Do you still agree with that characterization?
We don't know where we're going to have some failures. Undoubtedly, we'll have some little things. It's going to be clearly in the category of nuisance. I'm very confident we don't have major problems now.
You said that by December 31st, there will be six systems, including THAAD, that won't be ready. What are the other five?
Oh, boy, I was afraid you'd ask that. We'll give you for the record, but they're all new developments, things that are not going to be operational. But we've been keeping track of them because it's a major system currently under development. It's all the same category.
You addressed this in one of your bullet points in the summary graph, but I wonder if you could address for us here in a little more detail what type of coordination the Department of Defense has made with other countries, particularly ones with strategic arms, to make sure that a mistake on their side won't affect us.
Why don't you talk about what we've been doing with our allies, and then I'll say something about Russia.
In general, then, with...
This is Art Money. Art Money, he's in charge of this whole area. Okay. If there's a nuisance, he's it's his fault.
Okay. or I'm it. Let's see, there's been heavy interaction with several nations. Bill Curtis over here has held what we call workshops with allies. We've had several in the NATO area. We've had interactions with the Soviet or with the Russians that Dr. Hamre will talk to. 30 or 40, help me, Bill, on the number of interactions with various countries. Another hat I wear is in the C3I area is the representative to NATO. So there we've discussed with the 16 sitting NATO members plus the three about to be new members how the Y2K problem might or might not hamper operations from the alliance. So there's been fairly extensive discussions. But I will point out we have not had interaction with every country in the world. By any means, it's been more the folks that we're more closely aligned with. We've had outreach to others, but in some cases that hasn't been picked up as much as we would like. The Russian area in particular.
Yeah, if I could also say Mr. Money has outlined is the relations that we have had, the Department of Defense, to our counterparts in these other countries. Of course, each of the cabinet offices has been asked and charged for working with their counterparts in other countries. So there's much wider activity than just that. But we're talking about how we have been dealing with military establishments in other countries. As it relates to Russia, and I'll come right back to you. When it relates to Russia, I think everyone's primary concern revolves around early warning systems. We have had discussions, and as you know, President Clinton and President Yeltsin in September agreed on a program to get shared early warning. We have a delegation that's going over next week to further work out the details of that. We will be able to have that operational if we can make progress with our counterparts in Russia over the next couple of weeks.
When you say you're talking to the other countries, are you providing them the technology or say this is how we're doing it? This will be the fix?
In some cases, but in others it's sharing lessons learned on both sides, how to best approach areas. I think probably our biggest contribution to some of these other countries has been the extensiveness of testing, not only the individual system, but then the functional, cross-functional, ultimately, as you heard here from Colonel Patterson, in a syncope eval. I think what comes to mind is a lot of countries thought just testing the individual system was maybe enough, and I think that's maybe where our contribution's been the most extensive. Yeah. Just to add on to the where we interface, and we do have dependencies not only in the civil sector but with other parts of the U.S. government, there's an interface, what we'll call an interface document that's written, were in discussed and signed, so any interaction as systems meet each other, like what Dr. Hamre mentioned in passing data to the Treasury Department and so forth, those interfaces meet, how they meet has been well known, and an interface document's been signed, so in fact the electrons can pass. That will also be tested, however.
Do you have any cost estimates to date on how much it's cost to make all the systems compliant, and are you within your budget projections?
It's like Carl said, billions and billions. No, it's expensive. I think it's probably going to be $2.5 billion by the time this is all done. The last $1 billion was appropriated by Congress in the supplemental. We're in the final stages of getting that released. It's a very extensive effort, and if I might reference back to the previous question, there isn't a magic technology key that unlocks this problem for all systems. It's just an awful lot of pick and shovel work going through lines of code, and so it does take time and lots of testing to make sure you've uncovered things. One of the things we found out in our discussions on over the weekend were that there were a number of systems that came to us where the contractor said it's fixed, it's ready to go. We submitted it to detailed testing and found out there were still problems, but we had enough time to turn it back and turn it around.
We're glad to hear that NORAD and STRATCOM and so on are prepared, but if I could return to the Russia issue for a minute. The same concerns exist when it comes to the Russian nuclear arsenal, certainly, and you mentioned their early warning systems. What's your sense of Russia's Y2K preparedness at this point, and what is the DoD doing in working with the Russian military in terms of trying to make sure that situation is also under control? Is there any concern? Do they have the equivalent of our, I guess, now retired football? The mobile launch capability. How concerned are you about all that, and what is DoD doing in terms of working with the Russians to try to address that?
Or the United States, even outside of DoD?
Yes. Secretary Cohen has discussed this on three separate occasions with Minister Sergeyev. Minister Sergeyev has been appreciative of those discussions, and as we indicated in the, all of that preceded the meeting that the President had with President Yeltsin that led to the shared early warning. My sense is that Russia is not as fully aware of the extent that this is a problem, and so they are not. They don't seem to have the same level of urgency that we have had over it. Having said that, I think we feel very comfortable that they will be able to retain positive control over their nuclear inventory. They have had invested extensively in positive control over their infrastructure. And the default for failure is not to launch. The default is to freeze things up. You know, so we're not anxious that there are going to be accidental occurrences as a result of Y2K for nuclear command and control systems. Having said that, we want to have the least amount of uncertainty in anyone's minds as to the implications, which is why we have entered into the discussion, why we're sending yet another team, why we hope that we can enter into the shared early warning environment this year.
You know, if we could stick with Russia for a minute. I'm sorry, Bob. Do you have any concern about the early warning or the false, and are you planning on deploying troops differently, standing troops down here? Are you going to exchange troops for the event? Are you going to have, you know, a Russian in NORAD and an American in their equivalent facility?
Again, our concept of operations is that there will be a shared early warning center where both Americans and Russians will be side by side participating in early warning, much as we did for air traffic control in Berlin when Berlin was still an isolated city. We had Americans, French, British and Russian technicians sitting side by side for 25 years. And that's very much the image that we have of this.
Is this something that will be built? Do you have a good grasp on where that will be and how it will function?
That is exactly the purpose of the delegation that we are sending over next week, as part is to further that discussion.
You know, you envision there a European-based facility or?
We are prepared to do it in Europe. We're prepared to do it here in the United States, and it's part of the follow-up. I really have to wait until those meetings take place and the discussion occurs.
Along the same lines, is that primarily been initiated because of the concern about Y2K, or was that something that was in the works before?
It had been in the works before, although the year 2000 has brought a new sense of urgency, as it were, to trying to get that part of it going. We see it as a backdrop to a general environment of trying to lower tensions and uncertainties as it relates to missile launches around the world, and so this is a key part of it. But that we are prepared to move faster and have made arrangements to be able to do that if we can, before 2000 if we can.
Yes, sir. Where's this Y2K command post going to be domestically, and who's going to operate it?
I'm sorry?
You talked about a Y2K command center.
It's John Koskinen, who is the designated focal point for the president for year 2000, is in the process of deciding how to set that up and what kind of a clearinghouse mechanism that will be. We're going to have a series of, as I said, tabletop exercises to design that over the next couple of weeks.
Is it going to be a DoD facility? Are you going to provide most of the computers and comm? Is it going to be run by FEMA? Is it going to be run by OMB?
My sense is, Art, you may know better here, or Bill may know.
I think that's also part of the TBD, but DoD will in fact have its own anyway. But it has that plugs into the to the overall government. That's part of what Dr. Hamre just referred to. But DoD will have another one.
I think the centerpiece of it will largely revolve around FEMA and the emergency response plans in each of the states. But again, let me just emphasize again, everything we see is that American industry is really getting on top of this problem. We have very close ties. Again, Art is responsible, Mr. Money is responsible for this, with the telecommunications industry, because we run the emergency telecommunications network, you know, for the United States. And we have extensive contacts with the major telcos. And they are going to be ready. We do not envision problems in telecommunications. We are hearing very reassuring things about the energy networks. And just yesterday, I was, because the secretary is out of town, I went to a cabinet meeting, and John Koskinen gave a report to the president that we feel the electric distribution system, the power distribution system, is going to be fine. So, but we still need to do responsible planning, and we will be doing that. And the best way to do that is through a series of exercises, to what-if questions, as it were. Right behind you.
Yeah, you mentioned THAAD and some other new systems that aren't yet compliant. I thought this whole Y2K problem was because of computers that date back to the 70s and early 80s. How is it that systems that are now being built or not yet built are not compliant?
It's not that they're not compliant. It's that the code is being written and it hasn't gone through the certification process. So, I mean, frankly, the things that were going that weren't going to become operational until the next century, we just didn't worry about them, although we're keeping track of them. So don't be anxious about that.
Yes, sir.
Just a system question. Could you speak to the capability and the projection for the ability of the Trident submarine command and control in the context of the larger Y2K issue here, specifically on that?
Matter of fact, we did talk about that on Saturday, and the Trident system right today is compliant.
So at least two states are going to have their National Guard standing by, I guess, the last 2 weeks of this year. Can American service members in other places or active duty people find that their Christmases are going to be right?
I'm glad you asked that, because I have seen these reports, and what I think has been mischaracterized is the sort of planning that is going on both at the state level and at the federal level that is in this category of consequence support. There is no mobilization plan right now for bringing the National Guard out or active duty military. We're not going to know the extent to which and how we should best support the civil sector until we go through some of this planning. And people shouldn't be anxious about that. I mean, we will be ready to support whatever has to happen, but we're not going to know the dimension of that yet for another couple of weeks. So nobody's going to lose their Christmas, I don't believe, worrying about that problem.
Can I go back to the money, the $2.5 billion? Is that what you projected?
This is the money.
He's the money. I know. Money will handle money. Yeah. Is the $2.5 billion about on target what it was going to cost to project? And does that include, have you already factored in the testing through the end of the year?
Yes. Yes is to the latter question. The former is very tough to estimate. The going in estimates were for each line of code that was in a more or less standalone system, maybe it was a dollar per change. If it was an embedded line of code, it might be as much as $8 per change. Those are gross and average numbers. What we know is it's costing us roughly $2.5 billion to do the remediation and also then go through all the testing.
What was your last projection on what it would cost?
We had one OMB report for a $1.9 billion, and then the next OMB report.
The first OMB, we have monthly OMB reports, and up till recently it was about $1.9 billion. But then we laid in the extensiveness of this testing that we wanted them to go through. That added another $600 million to get you to the 2.5 rough numbers.
You're going to ask for more money?
We'll see how these tests go. If you recall that slide that Dr. Hamre showed, there's a first test and there's a backup for every one of those in case something goes awry. If that's the case, we are likely to need some more, but that'll be TBD after we see the existence of the first test.
I put on my old comptroller hat. No, ARC doesn't get any more money. You've got to make it work with this. Yes, ma'am.
On the delegation that's going to Russia, is that strictly DOD people, or who's going? Is it
I think it's largely DOD. We may have some representatives from the National Security Council and from the State Department. We usually go on issues like this with the State Department as well.
Who's leading the delegation?
Well, it's Ted Warner's shop, but I'm not sure if he's going himself personally or if he has someone else going. We'll find the answer.
Thank you.
We think it's dead.
When is this that they're going?
I think it's next week. I think that was what I heard from Ted. We'll find that out.
You said that Russia's not taking it quite as seriously at this point as perhaps they could. That's not necessarily confidence inspiring. If you know
well, could I just say, what I need to say is they may be taking it seriously, but they've got a lot of other pretty serious problems. Okay. So I think therein lies our nervousness about it. We would love to see in Russia the same degree of passion about this that we have. We have to understand that they are a very different situation. They have come to this much later. They haven't had country is going through some fairly profound changes, and so they haven't had the central focus. It's only been about a year that they've had an office that was really trying to work this problem, with astounding changes that have been going on. So we would like to see more, but we're grateful that they have positively responded when we've raised the issue. As I say, things that we're most concerned about, they are engaging with us on it. So I don't know what more I can say. I think we feel good about what we have right now.
But given their intercontinental nuclear capability, and hopefully a lot of this is media hysteria, but we have seen a lot of reports about how things are going to go haywire and power grids will go down and communications will fail, and who knows how computers are going to react or how people will react when their computers fail.
I think those are the same people who are trying to sell gold bullion.
That's right, canned water.
How
confident are you at this point that's not going to be a serious issue? You can speak authoritatively about our Department of Defense,
yes.
But...
and it took us a lot to be able to get to this level of confidence for us. And we don't have that, obviously.
How sure can you be that the Russian military will be up to speed when the moment comes?
Undoubtedly they're going to have difficulties, and undoubtedly they're going to have problems that they don't anticipate right now. But as a military entity, they have been far more conservative for human intervention for control and have had far less of a dependence on strict automated command and control systems. So they will have backup and redundancy that we frankly have never engineered into our systems. So again, we're not forecasting that they won't have difficulties. But I think we should also not try to create frightening hypothetical scenarios that I don't think are in scale with the way we understood that they've organized themselves for 35 years.
Still a lot of work to be done.
There's a lot of work to be done, absolutely. Yeah, and we do too. I don't want to overstate it. We're not finished yet here. We got an awful lot of work ourselves here.
Any area that does greatly concern you? Any country or any area in this country that bothers you?
Well, I think as I said, we have a good deal of insight into the telecommunications industry, and we feel fairly confident about the telecommunications industry. We don't have, because we DOD don't have an oversight or a liaison role into the energy industry in America. And so we are dependent on what we're being told by other organizations. We're hearing encouraging things, but we know less about that. And so I think therein lies, matter of fact, on Saturday, almost invariably, one of the questions that, well, we still don't know about installation X. You know, the power grid may be fine across the country, but what may happen in an individual locality? We have some uncertainties there, and that's what we've got this year to work through. We think the banking structure is going to be fine. Banking and finance structure is going to be fine. So we're not as anxious there. I'm talking largely the United States. Overseas, obviously, we look to see where people have been spending the greatest amount of attention. And it has been almost to our level, I think, based on Mr. Money's reports, you see comparable level of energy in Canada and in the United Kingdom and in Australia and in Germany and places like that. You will see, you know, very intensive activity. You see less intensive activity in Asia, but I don't know that that means that they aren't doing it. It may mean that we just don't have insights. And so, but again, we need to separate our lack of knowledge from our fear of that the worst case is going to occur. I think that's, we have to reassure people that's like, it's a very different situation, I think. But it took a lot of us, a lot of work for us to get to that phase.
Got a handle on how the Chinese are doing.
No, I don't think we have too much insights into China. But remember, the basic military posture doesn't cause us to be worried that there are going to be, you know, unacceptable, catastrophic consequences. We don't think that's going to be the case at all.
Yes, sir.
Will Congressman Horn have the same confidence in your Y2K efforts?
I don't know, but his chief of staff sat through our entire session on Saturday. And so I know he intends to have some hearings. We gave him every bit of the material that we were using ourselves. He sat through the entire session. So I hope that we have helped to build some confidence in Congressman Horn, too. We also had representatives from the Senate Oversight Committee, Senator Bennett's committee. The chief of staff was there from his committee. All through Saturday, and we had representatives from our defense oversight committees as well.
In October, when you met with a group of reporters, Dr. Hamre, you predicted that 95% of mission critical systems would be ready by this date, by the first of the year.
Yeah.
You're 81%.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be 93% in March 99. The OMB says you have to be 100.
Mm-hmm.
So why should we have confidence that you will be 100% by the year 2000?
Well, we now know with every single system where it is, where it stands, independent looks at it. I didn't have that kind of knowledge back in October when I met with all of you. It was our forecast, very much what we were hoping to be the case. We fell short of where we wanted to be, but I know we will be able to make it based on what we've seen. Believe me, we've grilled everybody, and it's because the people that have to go to war are the ones that are now checking to make sure that it's going to be there to support them. So I feel pretty good about it now.
If I may, Defense Secretary Cohen had threatened to impose a moratorium on the development of new software and to modify what you already have. With the progress you've made, is that still necessary?
My feeling is, I haven't yet reported this to the Secretary because he's been on travel, but I don't believe that we're going to need to do that now. I believe that there is sufficient energy and discipline in the system that we don't have to do that at this stage.
My final point here is that the number of mission critical systems appears to be growing since OMB, the OMB report in November. I could be wrong about this, but is there a fluctuation of the number that are identified?
It moves up and it moves down as you study a case, and you find out that one system is really a subroutine in another system, or you'll find something that you thought was one system, turns out there are three variants. And so the number does bubble around a little bit. But it isn't a dramatically different picture, I think.
Yeah, and let me just add that as time has gone along, back to your previous question, we know a lot more now than we did in the plan for October. Consequently, our confidence is heightened. So I strongly believe this plan greater than I believe the October plan. So back to your first question. The number of mission critical systems is in fact declining because as you work through this, something that was once deemed to be mission critical, people say that's no longer necessary, especially since the SYNC's involvement started to happen. And also probably that other number you're referring to was 1900 or whatever. This combined the intelligence programs that were needed in addition to all the others, where we had kept that separate in a lot of the previous reporting. So this is total DOD, roughly 500 intelligence systems are embedded in those numbers.
Is there a problem in that there's not a standard definition of what is a mission critical system? Is that changing as you go?
Well, part of it's what's mission critical in the eye of the beholder. If you had a program manager that came forward and says, "Oh, my system isn't mission critical," you'd probably fire them. You know, you want them to believe that what they're working on is critical, and so a lot of it was definitional. In the earlier phases, we were letting other people to define for themselves whether what they were working on was critical or not. That led to an overpopulation, as it were, of the list of mission-critical systems. We feel very confident that these systems have to work on the 1st of January if we're going to be able to carry out our composite mission here in the department.
Do you know how many systems were considered mission-critical at the beginning of this process that are no longer considered mission-critical?
I don't remember how many scrubbed out. A couple hundred, I suppose.
More, yeah.
or more.
It's more than just weapons, and it's transportation, communications.
The little thing that makes labels in the grocery stores and our commissaries, it's all that kind of stuff. People in our building, you don't say you're not mission critical. It's like people not saying they're not mission essential when we have government shutdowns. Everybody wants to be here. It has been outsiders looking at it to say, do we have to have this system or not? Does it have to function the way it currently functions or not on the 1st of January? That became the criteria.
So hundreds of computer systems or computer networks shifted from the mission critical category to the non-mission critical category.
We're still working on them. Those are all being tracked as well. I'm just giving you the report on the ones that have to work.
Hamre, what impact do you think that this is going to have, that the problem is going to have on U.S. military operations overseas? For example, would you envision aircraft not being able to fly into airports in some countries that, we're not convinced are Y2K compliant?
I personally don't believe so, because we're part of what the FAA is charged to do, Department of Transportation is charged to do, is to work through the international, air transportation thing, what's called ICAO, I think it's called, to make sure that those systems are going to be functioning. And everything we're hearing is that that's not going to be a problem. Now, we do, of course, have contingency, capabilities that we can take in if it's a military activity that needs to be sustained. So I don't personally believe we're going to have problems when we get to that. But we have backup capabilities in the Department of Defense.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good. I don't have any announcements. Let me see if there are any questions. Yes.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask about both bomb damage assessment from the last several days of strikes in northern Iraq, and also thus far gun camera footage has not been released from those strikes, and I'd like to ask why not and request the footage be made available.
I certainly know of your interest in gun camera footage, and on many occasions we are anxious to get gun camera footage released to the media so that everyone can see the effectiveness of our weapon systems. In this particular instance, we have some concerns from an operational security standpoint. And so we will not be releasing, at least for the time being, the gun camera footage.
What does that mean?
That means that in some cases, the gun camera footage can provide to potential adversaries information that may be valuable for them in taking measures which would counter our weapons. And to the extent that we can, we want to minimize those. And in those instances, we withhold gun camera footage and other information that may prove of value to these potential adversaries.
Is that at all because of the the use now of this AGM 130? Boosted laser smart bomb that's been employed, does that have some different capability from the other weapons you've used that you're trying to protect?
This, without addressing the specifics of this weapon system, other than to say that I believe that the recent use of that weapon is the first in this kind of a situation. Indeed, in many cases, as we deploy weapons and before they are widely analyzed by the international community, they provide a capability and an effectiveness to the operational forces that we want to preserve to every possible extent.
But that is the video that you're withholding is the video of that of the use
that
of that weapon.
That is correct.
Right?
We are withholding the video from that particular weapon system.
Is there also harm video that's not being released?
We have released harm video in the past. I have not seen any harm video, which is available in the over the last couple of days.
Why would this material have been a risk to operational security? If it was not a risk to operational security last week, rather, why would it be a risk to operational security now?
Well, I just haven't seen any harm video that that we even have. There may be some, but I am not aware of any that we even have.
Is this a Defense Department decision to withhold this, or did this come at the request of the White House?
This is a Defense Department decision.
Did the White House request that this video not be released?
No, in fact, they did not.
Does this mean it's a decision by Secretary Cohen himself?
It means it's a decision by people who are operators and who have a role in this operation and in consultation with others in the building here. Ultimately, of course, Ken Bacon makes the decision.
But you're saying that it is possible for, if harm missiles are used in this current set to with Iraq, if the types of attacks continue that have been in the past and harm missiles are used, that type of video could be released?
There are types of video that we have released in the past and that we may be able to release in this situation. I'm not at this point in a position to be able to predict exactly which ones we'll release and which ones we won't. But for these particular pieces of gun camera footage, we're not releasing.
Can you give us any details on the latest incident today?
Well, let me go through this. There were two separate events this morning. This on the 14th of January, early in our day on the east coast of the United States. First one, at about 4:15 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, involved a U.S. F-16 CJ, which was involved in routine enforcement activity over northern Iraq, fired high-speed anti-radiation missile and an Iraqi surface-to-air missile and anti-aircraft artillery system that posed a threat to coalition forces. That's the first one. The second one was a U.S. F-15E, which launched an AGM-30, one of these precision-guided munitions, at a SAM system that was a threat to coalition forces.
When you say they were a threat, does that mean that they were illuminating these specific aircraft, or what does that mean?
Yes. I think that most of you are aware that the aircraft get their best read when they are illuminated.
Were there any missile launches from the ground in either incident?
I am not aware of any missile launches, but we're still looking at that. There are some initial reports that give us additional questions that we want to look into. Well, that's what I say. We don't have any firm indicators at this point, but there is some question that we want to look into further.
Well, what about the, you said this radar was connected also to anti-aircraft artillery.
Right.
Was there any artillery fire?
That's another thing that we want to look into. There have been some reports of artillery fire, but it's not clear at that point.
What's the effective range of these anti-aircraft artillery systems? We know that surface-to-air missiles
right.
have the capability of reaching planes, but what's the effective range of artillery, and do U.S. and British planes patrolling the no-fly zones, do they routinely fly above the effective range of artillery?
The answer to the second question is that they fly above the range of AAA and I can't give you a range right now, but it's significantly less than the altitude at which our aircraft fly. Just one second, let me get.
Mike, you have any comment on the news reports out of Ankara and the Turkish media that the United States has agreed to send some Patriot batteries to Turkey?
I have seen those reports. Indeed, we are in receipt of a request from the government of Turkey for Patriots. We're presently reviewing that request. I think you are aware that we are interested in being as supportive as we can to any of our coalition partners who are involved in this operation, and we will be looking at their request and reach a decision on that very soon.
How many Patriots?
This does not get into numbers. It addresses a capability.
Could I ask two quick ones? One, is Ankara reacting to a specific threat, or are they just aware of the growing tension in the region? And also, were in this morning's incidents, were both aircraft illuminated or just one illuminated? I wasn't clear on that.
Well, my understanding is that in both cases, there was certainly the pilots felt a threat from these sites and took appropriate action. The point that I made was that the indicators that a pilot gets of the location of these sites is from radar illuminations. Now, to answer your first question, which had to do with the specificity of the Turkish request, I can't say exactly what motivated them, but I think everybody is aware of the change in operations that we've seen in Operation Northern Watch and in Operation Southern Watch on the part of the Iraqis. And as you know, Operation Northern Watch is flown out of a Turkish air base, and we certainly appreciate the support of the government of Turkey as we undertake this mission in cooperation with them.
Does the United States, let's go back to cause, why there would be a need for Patriots or a desire on the part of the Turks. Is the United States capable in its surveillance of Iraq of detecting any rollout, setup of Scuds, of missiles that could threaten Turkey or, for that matter, Saudi Arabia or Kuwait? Are we watching?
Bill, I think, as you know, we have a very robust capability to watch to the extent that we can what the Iraqis are doing. This includes not only the activity from the surface-to-air missile sites, but also any kind of Scud activity. I am not aware of any kind of Scud activity, but we have said in the past that we believe that the Iraqis did retain some Scud capability after the Gulf War.
And are we ready to act if there is any setup of such weapons?
I think, Bill, you're certainly aware that the whole purpose of the operations that we're conducting to enforce the no-fly zones includes not only the capability to protect segments of the Iraqi population from Saddam Hussein's very violent attacks on them in the past, but also to provide an early warning indication should he at any time threaten his Gulf neighbors. Or neighbors in the region, for that matter.
I just wanted to ask two things. Yes. You said the Turks had asked for capability. Was that, in fact, for the protection of Incirlik?
They have asked for Patriots. I don't know that they specified where these Patriots would be used. My guess is that it would be in that region, yes.
And I can ask a follow-up more on a policy level. From the Pentagon's point of view, just how long does this sort of daily, every morning tit-for-tat go on? Does it go on till they run out of SAMs and radars because you've taken them out but one by one? I mean, what do you do about all this?
Mm-hmm. Well, certainly the United States has been involved in this effort since 1991 in the north and 1992 in the south. As I mentioned on Tuesday, we've flown 140,000 sorties in support of these no-fly zone enforcements. Altogether, the coalition has flown 200,000 sorties. We are determined to continue to enforce the no-fly zones as part of our overall policy with regard to Iraq.
Well, I guess that's what I'm asking. What is the overall policy now? Is in fact, just to keep doing the once every morning hit on Iraq, or is there some possibly more comprehensive solution available?
Well, I think you know that the central elements of our policy with regard to Iraq are that, number one, they must comply with all of the relevant Security Council resolutions, and secondly, that in accordance with the UN Security Council demands that Iraq must be disarmed of its weapons of mass destruction. And as part of UN Security Council resolutions and pursuant to those that have been set up over the years, the coalition established these no-fly zones to essentially to protect these population segments from Saddam Hussein, and as I say, to provide this capability for early warning. We're determined to continue doing that, and it is not a determination that is going to be marked in days or months. It's going to be marked by the actions of Saddam Hussein.
Mike, this week Baghdad has made some strong statements saying it doesn't recognize the borders of Kuwait. To what extent is that a cause for concern?
I think you've seen that Secretary Cohen addressed that. He considers that a very serious matter. But the statements of the Iraqis in the past have come frequently. And what we here in the Pentagon and out in the Northern Watch areas and the Southern Watch areas are doing is to watch his actions more than to analyze his words.
And are there any actions that back up those words, any troublesome movements of troops or other preparations that would indicate Saddam might be considering a move to the south?
No, we have not seen any kind of ground activity that indicates that. Yes.
Mike, in the past 4 days, there have been, about half a dozen instances where we've dropped bombs or fired missiles at Iraqi sites. I can only think of two where they have said anything about whether or not there was a hit. What's the effectiveness been? Do you have any more details on
that? I don't have a full rundown on the effectiveness. I can say this, that we fire those weapons when we believe that our air crews and pilots are threatened by SAM sites or by radar systems that are integrated into an air defense unit. We'll continue doing that. I think you know from yesterday that there was a strong indication that we had been very effective. There are other occasions where we have not been so effective, but we will continue to enforce the no-fly zones as we have in the past.
In situations where this was my next question also, we haven't been getting a lot of bomb damage assessment recently. At roughly the same time, we stopped receiving gun sight camera video. Shouldn't the bomb damage assessment from these incidents be in by now? Is this something that's just not being made available to us for whatever reason? Or should we assume that these are misses if we don't get the BDA and don't get the tape as to what happened?
That's a good question, and we'll try and in the future get a little finer analysis of the assessment, and to the extent that we can, we'll provide it to you. Yeah.
Did you increase recently the number of U.S. aircraft initially for Northern Watch, and why most of skirmishes which are taking place right now are taking place around Mosul?
To answer your first question, the number of aircraft involved in Northern Watch out of Incirlik does fluctuate from time to time. although over the last several weeks it's remained constant, and I can give you that number if you're interested. At present, we have 38 U.S. aircraft involved in Operation Northern Watch, a greater number involved in the Gulf area that supports Southern Watch. That number is 182. The SYNC, of course, in both regions has a responsibility to assess the requirements that he feels are necessary in order to carry out his mission, and so it may be that in the future that number in Northern Watch will go up, as we expect the number in Southern Watch to go up over the next several days when those deploying F-16s get to the Gulf region. Yeah.
How many of those F-16s are going? Is there eight?
There are eight and four tankers that will be accompanying them. They were to have left today, but because of weather, they did not. Our expectation is now that they will depart tomorrow.
Are the tankers KC-135s?
Let me see if I've got that with me. But I'll tell you what, let's get you that information, and we'll get back to you, Bill. Okay.
And why Mosul?
Oh, Mosul. Mm-hmm. I think there, first of all, when we talk about location here, we use that because that particular city is marked on most maps that are available to you. Actually, the site is some distance from the city, or these sites. There are an array of them. And I think that the reason that much of this activity has been up there is because this is where they have a lot of these SAM sites. This particular area is probably the largest of the communication and oil infrastructure hubs up in that part of Iraq, and it may be that the Iraqis have deployed these systems because of that particular capability. Yes.
Has the department changed its view of oil for food at all?
First of all, I would refer you to the Department of State on oil for food. I think that it is best for them to address that subject. Yeah, Jamie.
Well, new subject, or do you still have Iraq questions?
Does anybody else have any more on Iraq, Bill?
No, I see.
Okay.
Well, I wanted to ask you about the Pentagon yesterday released some reconnaissance photographs showing the first bomb damage from the August 20th strikes on the suspected terrorist training camps in Afghanistan. In particular, one of the pictures purports to show a row of buildings, five buildings, which we are told was housing for top officials in Osama bin Laden's organization. Can you tell us what those pictures show in terms of the effectiveness of the U.S. strikes?
First of all, I should point out for those of you who have not seen these pictures that they're available on our website that is available to almost anybody who has computer capability. What these pictures show is that there was significant destruction to this particular site that was struck. It is an indication that these facilities that were being used by this terrorist group are not out of the reach of the United States, and where we can locate them and where we can disrupt their planning and their infrastructure, we have the capability to do so.
Was Osama bin Laden believed to be at that in that complex of buildings at the time that strikes took place?
We knew at the time the strikes took place that there was going to be a meeting of these terrorists for the purpose of planning further attacks against U.S. people and U.S. facilities. And our actions, if you will recall the statements of the leadership at the time, were designed to disrupt that kind of activity. And we believe they were very effective in doing so.
Subsequently, we obviously now know that Osama bin Laden survived the attacks because he has given interviews. Again, I just ask my question again. Was he believed to be at that location when the attack took place?
At the time the attack took place, we knew that there was going to be a meeting of Osama bin Laden's organization. The attack was against the infrastructure and the planning that was going to be going on at the time. The attack was not against any specific individual. And I think most of you are aware that we have long said that military forces are not an effective tool to be used against individuals.
Well, you know, I'm going to try this one more time, but you only get four possible answers. And the question is, was Osama bin Laden at the site at the time of the attack? And your possible answers are yes, no, I don't know, I'm not going to say.
Let me get back to you. Suzanne.
Can you say how this significant destruction was brought about? By what weapon system?
No, we have never announced the weapon systems that were used.
Why not?
Again, to the extent that we can, we talk about the capabilities of our weapon systems. On this particular occasion, we elected not to get into the specifics of the types of weapons that were used, nor the particular starting points for the launch of those weapons.
Why can we have so many pictures be displayed of the types of destruction that were attained against Iraq? And that doesn't seem to be any problem with telegraphing to Saddam Hussein what kind of weapons are being used against him, but for some reason Osama bin Laden isn't supposed to know what's being used against him? I don't quite get that.
I think we look at these things on a case-by-case basis, and in this particular case with this particular group, we felt that it was appropriate not to provide detailed information on what weapon systems we'd used in these instances.
Aren't you really, in effect, just keeping from the American people what types of weapon systems are used?
No, actually, we would love to, and have on many occasions, talked about the effectiveness of our weapon systems, and certainly at some point in time, we may be able to do that in these cases. But to this point, we have not released that kind of that level of information.
Yeah. But there seems to be a growing ability on the part of the Pentagon to use those reasons, rationalizations, whatever you want to call them, for a lack of willingness to discuss certain types of operations. Is there an individual behind this, such as General Shelton, who is not really quite as open as perhaps other chairmen might have been? Or perhaps is this more a reflection of the secretary's feelings? Where is this coming from inside the bureaucracy of the building?
I think that it's coming from the fact that we are facing in this age, a variety of threats on a variety of fronts from groups that have not been threats before, groups that are transnational, groups that are very well financed, groups that carry out their attacks in a very stealthy manner. They do not operate as organized threats have in the past, And as such, at this point in time, we believe that that our withholding of certain pieces of information is appropriate.
Can you confirm that there's planning going on in this building for future strikes against Mr. Bin Laden's associates in Afghanistan? And since you probably won't do that, can you reassure his associates that you're not going to strike him?
I can neither confirm any upcoming military operations, nor can I say that no such operations will be undertaken. In fact, I would say that based on the actions that we took in this particular case, we demonstrated that these organizations, where we can identify them and locate them, are not outside of our reach. And where we feel that we are threatened, we have the capability to take action, which is not only appropriate, but highly effective.
I just want to get back to this picture again that was released yesterday showing the five buildings. Does that, as we look at that picture, can we take from that that two of the buildings were destroyed and the other three were missed? Were there of the five buildings, there were three missed and two hit?
Almost total destruction in two of the buildings. There was significant damage to the other three, but not total destruction. Yeah.
China? Okay, thanks. Mike, there's a report yesterday from the, quoting the Chinese director, Chinese Foreign Ministry's Arms Control Director, Mr. Xia Zhuqing, that where China is warning and is very critical about a ballistic missile defense system, including Japan, Taiwan, and the United States. I would like to ask, what is the department's reaction? Why would China be? Why would China object to a defensive system, let's say, on Taiwan?
I have not seen those comments that you cite there, and so I will refrain from any comment on those particular comments. But what I will say is that the Secretary is presently over in that region of the world. He is talking to both our Japanese allies and our allies in the Republic of Korea. And one of the concerns that those allies have is over a missile capability which is being developed by the North Koreans. And I think, as you know, we have a multi-part missile defense program in the United States, one part of which is for theater missile defense, that is to say, defense against threats to our deployed forces and to people close into regions where our forces are operating. We have said, and the Secretary has indicated on his current trip, that he, the United States, is certainly willing to work with Japan as we develop those systems.
Do you think, though, go back to my second part, that China is showing its hand, so to speak, by saying, well, we want to hold you hostage to our missiles and deprive you of our of a BMD system?
I cannot analyze for you what the Chinese have said.
Okay, thank you.
In closing, I would just like to say that this, in some respects, is a sad day because one of the Pentagon press corps is leaving us. Suzanne Schaefer, who has been the Associated Press representative here in the building for longer than I have been assigned here, is going to be taking a leave of absence. She has been at her desk for many, many years, reporting very accurately and completely on the activities of the building, and we'll miss her. And Suzanne, we certainly wish you the best as you leave the building and as you focus attention on your family. And we look forward to many visits from you in the future, and hopefully you will return to the Pentagon Press Corps at some time.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Who's going to rearrange the furniture?
I didn't know about that.